All right, it is 3 p.m. and this is WZBC at noon. You're listening to Tidal Patterns, and today we're having a special interview with workers from the SimpliSafe call center, talking about the ongoing workers' struggle there and what's been going on. So we have Joaquin, as always, and we have Ryan, Abbie, and Lauren. SimpliSafe.
Good to be here.
Yeah, could you start by maybe telling a little bit about the situation, what's going on, and what happened in the last few weeks?
Yeah, so we work for SimpliSafe. It's an alarm company. We're in a call center in downtown Boston, right by the State Street T stop. There's a couple floors there. The three of us have been working there for a while. And starting in late October, us and other people started to hear about a bed bug situation in the office. What we discovered fairly quickly was actually this is a situation, bed bug infestation in the call center that goes back to probably March from what we've been hearing, if not earlier. And that a lot of people were being exposed to this. The office has a very high turnover rate. And so we decided we needed to do something about it because the company hadn't notified us of it. People were coming in, leaving quickly, getting bed bugs, taking it home to their families, and people were being kept in the dark. It relates to a lot of other issues. In some senses, this bed bug issue is a symptom of how they treat us in general, you know, very keeping us in the dark about larger issues and treating us like very disposably. I guess we can talk about that more in a bit. But we came together with others who are still there working right now. The three of us are suspended right now. We'll come to that too. And we started to draft a petition. It was very simple, just breaking down what had happened and asking for the company to apologize for the dishonesty and just to be transparent with us going forward about how the situation was handled. The company had been spraying at least since midsummer with various chemicals. They were telling us it was for mice. We found it was actually for bed bugs. And so I think it was 21 of us signed the petition before it was posted publicly. And then on Monday, the 6th of November, we posted it publicly in the break rooms on the third and fourth floor. Maybe someone else wants to pick it up from there, or I can keep going for a little while.
I could fill in from there. I mean, I just want to emphasize to people that it's just a big deal to post something publicly in this type of workplace because people have been very afraid to say anything. You know, people are replaced every week. There's a real feeling of being disposable. And of course, this is not the only workplace. It's something of a common feeling in many places like this. But then finally, when people came together and there were 21 people first who had their names on this petition, people didn't back down. And then another 15 signed publicly. And this was such a big deal for people to see. And then after that, there was something of a backlash where there was 2 days of meetings where the Human Resources said that the petition was spreading misinformation. And then a day after that, people were being hauled into offices, interrogated about the organization of the petition. And at that point, there had been a discussion among people who had signed it saying that, well, we don't want to lose our jobs over this. So if one person feels they're going to be fired for this, we're going to all stand up and say that this is not right, that we are simply doing what we needed to do and we have every right to do. And we're not going to just sit back like we've done so many hundreds of times and seeing our friends dragged out silently and fired. So we heard that a worker was about to be fired. Ryan actually felt that he was about to be fired by management, and I stood up and said that it wasn't right, and said that we said, hell no, we won't go. And from there, eventually, after about 10 minutes, we were told that Ryan wouldn't be fired. And so then we sat down, there was silence in the office, and then the cops came and dragged me away.
And that was on Wednesday the 8th, the evening of Wednesday the 8th, that occurred. Just to spout out a little bit, I was pulled into a two-on-one meeting with two members of higher management, and they started down the lines of trying to fire me in retaliation for the petition. And once they called that off, I left the room, and they said, we talk tomorrow. And I saw that the police were there to drag Abbie out of the office. And so, now I'm not going to be fired, but now someone else is being dragged out by the police. So myself and Lauren and others, I got up on top of my desk and started talking about what was going on and explaining it to people. And at first, people were shocked that was happening. But people were pretty receptive, and more people started to stand up and say this isn't right, and speak about other issues that were going on. This is around 5:30 on Wednesday the 8th. And then once that started to happen, other people speaking up and starting to call out all the injustice, all the oppression that they've been facing, the higher management said, everyone go home right now, leave the office, everyone needs to leave right now. And including, you know, my shift is till 6 p.m., but people generally work there, and the night shift works until midnight. So they're sending out everyone home 6.5 hours early, and we're the only call center, so they closed it down.
I want to ask Lauren, because when I was, I haven't really asked you about this, like when I was being let out or dragged out by at least 4 police officers, I started to hear all these people on the other side of the office, which was separated from mine, shouting like, hell no, we won't go. And I was curious how that played out, like, on your side, because it was really inspiring to hear.
It was very, it was a definitely, you could definitely feel the intensity in the office. You could definitely, like, cut it with a knife, you know. I can see a coworker coming, running towards the other side, speaking to Ryan, and I could feel the intensity and such. And so once Ryan got to his desk and I saw other coworkers looking shocked as well, I kind of just started to feel like, should I sit down if this happens or should I stand up? And as soon as I saw Ryan stand up on his desk, I didn't even finish my thought, and I just stood up, and it was one of the most daring things I've ever done. But I'm glad I was able to do it and be in support of this, because I definitely see that there needs to be a change, and we definitely need representation as a worker.
And I want to like emphasize what Lauren said there about the question of representation. Throughout the whole thing, after posting the bedbug petition, or the anti-bedbug petition, we can really call it, management from the supervisor level all the way up to the higher management kept emphasizing, look, this isn't the right way to go about it. Come to us one-on-one. You know, we'll talk about it one-on-one. But it was so two-faced, because people had been going to them one-on-one about this. People had caught and found and killed bedbugs in the office and brought it to them, and they were squashing it. A woman on Wednesday, the Wednesday before the petition was posted, would that be the 1st of November, she mentioned in her team chat, like we have little team chats in the office, that she'd heard about bedbugs, and her supervisor lectured her for 30 minutes about how she shouldn't be talking about that, how she was going to cause panic and all that sort of stuff. And then the next day she was fired, actually, on Thursday the 2nd of November, supposedly for unrelated reasons, but it was clearly because of that. And so many people, whether it be about the bed bugs or other issues, when they've brought up stuff in the office, in a one-on-one setting, or as individuals, the response from the company has been to squash it. And I mean, this isn't like, the bed bugs, they're one thing, but like I said at the beginning, this is, you know, a symptom of a larger problem. We're treated like disposable, like workers were just shuffled in and out of there. And people have come forward about being sexually harassed by supervisors repeatedly, and that's been squashed. People have been come forward, for example, about black workers have come forward repeatedly about the racism and white supremacy they face in the workplace, including some white managers calling black workers their slaves. And the response from higher management in these one-on-one meetings has been, you're misunderstanding what your supervisor's saying, even though it's pretty clear what the supervisor's saying. And has been to squash it and to interrogate and to, in some cases, even fire people, supposedly for unrelated reasons, but clearly in retaliation for coming forward about these things. So to come together as a group and put this out there was a big step for us. And some of us who signed it, not everyone, but some of us have signed it, have come together and formed a group called United SimpliSafe Workers. And we're pushing for the company to recognize this as a real legitimate workers organization that people can bring their grievances to, that people can come forward with problems to, so they're not isolated in these one-on-one situations. So they actually have a voice, and there can be actually some democracy in our workplace, as opposed to just being forced to accept whatever new rules or draconian policies the company imposes upon us.
Yeah. To maybe make things a little more real for people too, there was some footage that was recorded during the action, and I think we'll play a little bit of the footage from that now, including some of the speeches that were given, to give a sense of the tensions that were there in the workplace on that day.
I know people are being fired right now. I have confirmation that people are being fired right now. Stop trying to... We've seen it. We've seen people being escorted out like they're being escorted out of a prison. You know? We know it. And stop. I'm not talking to you. I have no problem. I have no need to talk to you because you're violating our rights. First Amendment rights. Told that this person is not any longer being fired. If this happens again, everyone should stand up and not take it. It's not right that they're interrogating people and interviewing them right now about what's legally their protected rights as workers here. So thank you.
All right, so that's some brief snippets from a video that was taken during the action by a worker who was just there. And you can hear, I think, during that, the speeches that were given. And you can hear also intermittent throughout it, like the responses by management trying to shut down the speeches and workers speaking out about what's been going on there. And then at the end, you heard the clip of that was happening as after Abbie heard they called the cops on him for supposedly trespassing. And then at the end, the chance that began that ended up shutting down the workplace from the distance.
It was something to hear because I haven't heard that since I was there. I just want to explain to people that this was a very kind of sudden situation, that we were afraid that people would be interrogated for signing the petition. And then when we got word that actually Ryan was at the verge of being fired, you know, there was a collective decision among people who had signed this to do something about it. Because we knew that we had responsibility to put this petition up, and that also if people saw people being suspended or fired in retaliation, that would just be a signal that nothing can change. So we had to stand up right there. And then when we heard that, okay, finally they were saying we weren't going to suspend or fire Ryan at that moment, there was kind of a feeling, okay, like maybe there's a way forward that we could discuss this with the company and with our fellow workers. And that's right when that clip, when the cops were sent in and dragged me away. So it wasn't, you said this was like a speech. It was more like kind of a call out of a situation that was playing out in front of us, including the chanting from the other side. You know, it was actually just extremely heartwarming, as I said before, to hear that, to finally hear that we are coming together as workers here and calling out what was right in front of us.
Yeah, and I think there was really something. Initially, you know, most people, I think, in the office were really surprised to see what was happening. I mean, some people knew it was going to happen in the beginning, but a lot of people didn't expect that to happen, and it was quite a shock. But I want to emphasize it again that you can hear at the end just more and more people starting to join in. unfortunately, the footage, the clip there, the audio recording, it's from the other side of the office, so you can't quite hear everything. But very quickly, after myself and Lauren and a few other people stood up, more and more people started to join in. And this, it became very clear to us that this is really what SimpliSafe is afraid of. They're afraid that people are going to speak up, are going to use their voices, and are going to talk about all the injustice and oppression that they face, but how the company treats them on a daily basis. They're afraid of the power that people have when they stand up and come together and oppose these sort of oppressive tactics that they use daily to keep us down. And really, you know, right now, because Abbie stood up, because others stood up, I was not fired. Now I'm suspended with pay. And as is Abbie and as is Lauren, and other people remain in the office and continue the struggle there, and we're continuing the struggle on the outside. And I think it's really important to see that as a major, major victory for us, that we weren't fired. They weren't able just to silence this and pick us off and pretend like everything's back to normal. Since this strike, they have responded by initially disabling everyone's key cards on Thursday morning. We use like little tap passes to get in and out of the office. So people initially weren't able to leave the buildings. The fire exits were locked, and people were quite terrified and didn't know what was happening. And now they have supervisors and executives from the companies posted at the entranceways and literally taking notes on people's comings and goings from the office to really instill a deep sense of fear in people. And we're not, you know, most of the people in the office were living paycheck to paycheck. And so they're really, the company is really trying to leverage that, in my view, to force people to be so afraid to stand up. And that's the way that it has been for a while. And this, the action that we've taken is a real attempt to change that dynamic. Yeah.
I just want to mention that I was only at this company for 5 months, and I never really gained like a full year, but it didn't take too long for me to realize some of the actions that they would use to dominate employees. They would treat us like children, and it's just it's not really a very welcoming spirit inside of that office. It's actually rather oppressive, and you don't really have a chance to breathe. And this was only just the straw on the camel's back. Like, it was bound to happen, and so I'm glad it happened.
I think that idea that the people are treated like children is a common refrain among our coworkers, even in this most recent episode about the bed bugs. When there were explanations that said that, well, the reason that we didn't tell you coworkers about the issue was because we wanted to protect the identity of people who had it. When those people who had bed bugs actually were not treated as they should have, they weren't fully compensated for taking care of the infestation in their homes. They were asked, as been said, to not tell anybody else about it. They were told to go home, not even compensated fully, in some cases for all the time, and possibly fired for even bringing this up in a team chat, as Ryan mentioned before. And people say, well, do they think we're stupid? Do they think we're children? And I think that a lot of the way that a call center like this works is actually designed to treat people like children, to kind of make them separated into small teams, to monitor everything that they say. We're not supposed to speak to each other, but just talk in a team chat. And if people say anything that's deemed a little bit rebellious, then they'll get reprimanded in small ways by a lead or a supervisor. In just a team of 10 people, we have 2 supervisors, one called a lead, one called a supervisor. So there's a tense feeling of just looking over one's shoulder all the time, you know, lest one step out of line. And I think we should see this as part of a larger historical trend in the U.S. about how to really compartmentalize workers into smaller and smaller buckets, you know, to keep them feeling very separated from each other, and to really feel like their one job is to keep their head down low, and that's what they're there for, rather than actually to be treated with dignity and respect, as all people deserve to be. And it's very hard to break out of that kind of self-imposed feeling of powerlessness. And you know, even I've been there almost a year, and I didn't realize the power we had, actually, that we could actually put up a petition and that we could keep it in the office for 3 days after people felt, even if against the most egregious outrages committed by supervisors and others that they couldn't say a word at risk of being fired right away. Every week there's a new team of people brought in of hirees or trainees are called, sometimes 20, sometimes 40, and marched around all the desks. Everyone sees them, that these people may replace you. And even out of those 40, 20 trainees, most often half of them are not hired. So why do they have twice as many people come in and walk around than actually are hired? It's really that feeling, again, I think, of the reinforcement of disposability, that idea of, well, you know, step out of line a little bit, there's someone who's going to be in your seat tomorrow. And I think that happened even with Lorne and Ryan. The day after they were suspended already, someone was right in their seat. You know, and people at the office see what that means and what that represents. It's deliberate.
You mentioned in the video that how people all the time see people being dragged out and fired from the workplace, like in a prison, almost escorted out, in also a very condescending way.
Well, let me clarify that I was dragged out. Most people are not literally dragged out, but in effect they are dragged out. Maybe some of the others can describe the ritual of what it's like to be fired at this place.
Yeah, it seems like, what happens generally is what happened to me towards the end of the day. You're called into an office with a couple members of higher management, and they give you a condescending speech about, you know, how you're not doing as well as you should be. And then you're walked out. Sometimes you're allowed to collect stuff from your desk. Other times you're not. You're just taken to the door and they get you the stuff later. And the reality is that it's quite a thing to see that happen to someone you know and have sat next to and have become friends with. And it's quite deliberate how they handle it. And people have been fired over things like missing a few days of work because of a sick family member, despite doctor's notes. People have been fired for all sorts of things, actually, that most people don't make it 3 months in the office, I believe. I don't know the exact statistics, but the turnover rate is immensely high. And we've heard even from people talking to staffing agencies that staffing agencies are like, what's going on with SimpliSafe? Why are so many people getting fired there? I mean, there's 300 people in the office, give or take. But they bring in 40-person training groups every week, as Abbie mentioned, and those people don't make it. And I just want to circle back to that these issues in the office are part of a larger sort of a social issue, a trend that we've seen in the U.S. and in different ways around the world to really squeeze what they can out of us, of working people. Since we've been there, since I started in early March, there's been a whole series of cutbacks to the limited benefits that we had. There's a petition on change.org where a worker who used to work, we posted about this, and someone who used to work there mentions that she worked on the night shift and they used to make $18 an hour and their wages were cut to $15 an hour in September of 2016. That was one thing. We used to get 10 paid time off days when we started. What? 15. We used to get 10 PTO days when we started at the company. And they cut it to 5 and then said we had to earn them back over time. We used to get 3-day weekends and holidays off. They made it so that we then had to make those days up. So instead of, like, if you would have like Friday, Saturday, Sunday off, you have Friday off, you come in on Saturday, then you have Sunday off. And they eliminated the morning shift where a number of people worked and tried to force them to work night shift. They've implemented new measures for keeping better track of our numbers and quantitatively evaluating our work. All these sorts of things. They forced us every time we get up to go to the bathroom now by the rules to say, be right back in the team chat. Things like that, just to really police our every action, to really create this culture that Abbie mentioned of feeling like you always have to look over your shoulder, and to really cut back on the very limited freedoms and benefits that we had there. The goal for us, in a meaningful sense, the kind of coming together to form United SimpliSafe Workers, is to reverse that trend, to bring people together, to struggle for change and for a more democratic workplace, so we have a say in how things are run, so we can oppose changes and firings and other things that we deem to be unjust. And just another thing to mention, we mentioned earlier the white supremacy in the workplace. The majority of the people who work at the call center are people of color, Black and Latino people mostly. The supervisors are, by and large, there are some exceptions, but by and large, white and upper management as well. The company primarily advertises on right-wing radio and television, and the customer base reflects those sort of politics. Customers will routinely verbally abuse people who work there based on how they speak. People have been fired for speaking with accents too much. People are really under a lot of pressure there to not talk about the rampant white supremacy, both from the customers and from the management. And when people do speak up, as we've said, they've been escorted out of the office in one way or another. And people generally are aware of that dynamic, that the person has stood up and has complained about a manager. I'll mention just a few more examples. There are countless ones, and I'm sure we don't even know all, even a small percentage of them. One manager on a team night was watching the movie. Their team was watching the movie Finding Dory. I haven't seen it, but I've heard that there's like a scene with it where a whale jumps free from SeaWorld. And the manager's comment, she said, that whale must be Mexican the way it jumps over the wall. She's a white manager, and numerous people on her team reported her for that, but she was not fired, and they were told that they were making a personal issue out of this. Clearly, it's not just a personal issue. Clearly, that sort of condescending and quite racist attitude is a problem beyond just a personal level, and that was one of a series of comments that that woman had made that the management did nothing to address, and actually, in fact, targeted people who reported those comments, and that's one example among many.
Yeah, I think we get a good picture of the condescending attitude that the managers there have for workers. So I'm wondering if you could spell out a little bit about how that condescending attitude played out with the issue of the bed bugs, and spell out a little more what the sequence that went on there.
Well, there were many cases whenever, like, for instance, Ryan, previously, whenever they would announce that there would be an extermination happening, Ryan would sometimes ask questions in the group chat, like, are we going to be present? What are these fumes made out of? Is it okay for us to breathe it? Things like that, because it is definitely a health hazard to be breathing in those dangerous fumes. We are not really supposed to be in the office when they just spray it, but there was one extermination when we had to come half an hour after they sprayed, and one woman on our team actually she vomited and she was nauseous the whole day, and she actually has many other medical issues, and that definitely triggered it along the lines. And so they definitely do not have our health within their interest at all, and it's very sad that we have to deal with that on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, I mean, on my side of the office, there was a similar thing when we were there the morning after a spraying. And I just want to emphasize why, if they've been spraying, has the issue not been fully remedied? And that's because we're a big office with carpeting, which has seems never been really replaced or thoroughly taken care of. And to really thoroughly take care of the problem, we may have had to be relocated temporarily to really get to the bottom of this issue. So they were kind of stopgap measures taken, us right back in the offices, not to impact the production schedule, you know, the service of the calls and such. So I was there a morning after a spring too, and I said, well, it seems I still smell the stuff here. You know, maybe we should open a window or something, even though we're not, the office is not really designed to open windows. And I was told, well, officially the note from HR is everything should be fine. And well, if you're smelling some fumes, you know, you might think that doesn't quite seem fine to me, even if authority is telling you it's fine. And but there's no recourse to that. I mean, there's just tremendous tension then. Even that question was, I was yelled at by not my own supervisor, but another supervisor for bringing that up. So I think another part of this is that a lot of people think of these issues as, well, this is just an exception and they'll fix the problem and it'll be fine. I think something that most of the workers, our coworkers, know is that this office is not really worse than other offices. You know, the same issues are in other types of call centers and similar types of workplaces. And that's what we're up against, is that it's acceptable to treat people like they're disposable right now in America and across the world. And to bring people together and say, that's not right, and we actually can unite and support each other and make for a better situation is a very hard thing to do, actually. And it requires people actually to step out of a comfort zone at first, too. Otherwise, people just are like, well, you step out of line, things might get worse for us. We might even lose that little paycheck that we're getting. So it's a very big deal that people sort of like they have and that people outside the community are realizing the significance of that as well. For instance, even on this radio show, to have us here and to tell our stories is something that we really appreciate, I think. Because a lot of people just say, oh, this is just a specific issue. It'll be resolved. There's two sides to every story. But really, the side of the perspective of the workers and the perspective of management and ownership is not just two equal sides. You know, you cannot compare these two sides. So to really flesh this out is something special, I think, even right here.
Just to already been said, the condescending attitudes were present throughout. I mean, we had these little sit-down meetings on Monday and Tuesday about the bed bug situation, and we were, you know, told just outright lies. And because, I mean, 21 of us came together and talked about what had happened, so we had a decent idea. The 21 of us who signed it initially before posting it publicly, we had a decent idea of what was going on in the office. The response from higher management was just to tell us more lies, to say they just found it a few days ago, even though people had been sent home weeks ago, that they just found out, and then that they were doing everything that was needed, not to worry. But we knew that they'd found out long before. They were telling us they'd given people paid time off. They actually had sent a lot of people home initially with telling people if they wanted to be paid, they had to use their own vacation days. And they really treated us like children and expected that we didn't know anything, that we wouldn't be able to talk to each other and figure out, like, see right through their lies. As Abbie mentioned, this is not such a unique situation. I mean, it's horrifying, the bed bugs and the other stuff that's gone on, but in many places around this country, probably in the city too, this stuff is happening. It's really powerful, I think, that we've come together in the way we have, and it's not by any means finished yet. The struggle does continue. We hope that others who are interested in what we've been doing and face similar situations would reach out to us as they see fit.
Tell them the email address.
Oh, yeah, we have an email address. It's UnitedSimplisafeWorkers@gmail.com. If people are interested in reaching out to us, they can do so there. And we'd be glad to discuss what's happened, whether it be with members of the press and other media, or with people who face similar conditions in their workplace, or just progressive and democratic people who would want to support our struggle and similar struggles.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing that information.
I was wondering, too, if you could talk a bit more about
the relation between, you mentioned, too, the history of oppression of workers in the U.S. and the ongoing, like, compartmentalization and the attempts to get more and more profit out of workers. I can see that at play, and I've seen that at play in workplaces I've worked at in the past, and we can see this at play clearly in the what you've all been talking about. But I was wondering if you could talk about the relation between this struggle to at SimpliSafe and stuff that's going on more broadly in the country, including workers' struggles and the history of that, and more recently the struggles against white supremacy and football protests and Black Lives Matter and things like that.
Even though this is a struggle that we're recently facing right now, it definitely does correlate with the struggle that Colin Kaepernick is going through right now. He's been it seems like he may be prospected to be a quarterback again, but he had to go through a whole year of struggle of having people insult his name, condemn him, and spit on him. He has donated millions of dollars. He has devoted his life to making sure that black people can be recognized as first-class citizens and to be treated as like human beings. And I totally admire his devotion and the fact that he was out of work, but he still managed to raise enormous amounts of money for after-school programs for kids like me and for kids in my neighborhood. And so I definitely feel like our struggle is not single to anything. It is definitely correlates with everything that's going on right now. And I feel like even if we have to wait a year to see any type of change, I'm definitely willing to sit there and wait. I mean, I know this is not about me. This is definitely about everyone else that's working at SimpliSafe and at other oppressive workplaces as well. So it's definitely not about me at all. So.
I think another relationship to Colin Kaepernick's struggle has been, I think when he first took a knee and it became really known what he was doing, there was a lot of criticism saying, well, is that the right way to go about this? You know, especially from people who watch football. And, you know, for us to talk about basic issues in our workplace, even with this petition, right away there was questions of, is this the right way to go about this? Should we wait until we have everyone in the office ready to put their name down publicly before we do anything? And then when people were being escorted and interrogated about the petition, should we have stood up? And some people said, well, it was right to stand up, but it was also quite heavy to see that happening, you know, after we've been sitting down for so long and maybe there was another way. But of course, we've seen so many of our friends let out silently and fired for things that they should not have been fired for and treated so wrongly. So the reality I think that we're all facing in this room and at our workplace, people are there right now, is that there really is no easy way to go about things, you know, that it is necessary to take a stand like Kaepernick did, even if at first it seems like not everyone is on board at first. Already there's just overwhelming new relationships formed among our coworkers, talking about the similarity between issues, the silencing that others have faced by when they've brought up things with supervisors, struggles that they've faced, and really finally people saying that, no, we shouldn't be afraid to come together. And of course, there are issues we need to overcome. We're not totally unified. But it's through coming together and discussing things that things are already opening up to an amazing degree, and things have already opened up in our office. Both in this issue with the bed bugs now, finally, with management taking accountability to a degree, saying that there is an issue publicly to them. It was a real fight just to get there. And even now to the degree in terms of people being treated better who have been sent home. I believe there's been more PTO given to them, people who have been sent home by bed bugs. And even like we said about Ryan wasn't fired. We're suspended with pay right now, and it took a real fight to make sure that happened, you know? So these are all things that have already been possible, and more things are being possible. But I really agree that there's such a relationship between now all across the country now, people starting to say that we need to really stand up together, you know, stand up against the trend. If there's not a path for how to do so, we need to set off on our own path right now, that there is no easy way to do so.
I want to circle back to another aspect of the question that you asked of the relation of this to white supremacy in the U.S. You know, a lot of the focus on white supremacy in the United States has correctly, in a meaningful sense, been on the police brutality and mass incarceration, and those are two very important aspects of it. But sometimes something that isn't so front and center is the nature of the workplace as actually a foundational site of white supremacy. There was a recent study that was put out, I don't remember the exact numbers, but that showed that the median household wealth, not income, but wealth for white families in the United States is around $150,000 compared to a little over $1,000 for black and Latino families, and trending downward for black and Latino people. And I think that's directly related to a lot of the stuff that we're facing at the workplace. I mean, the real treating workers as disposable, and treating especially black and Latino workers as far more disposable than their white counterparts. And then that's not to say that white people at the workplace don't have a difficult time too, but really the foundation of white supremacy is the meaningful sense built at the workplace and continued through the police brutality and through the prison system. The huge percentage of disproportionate amounts of unemployment amongst black and Latino people. The saying is, you know, black and Latino people are last hired, first fired. And we see that all the time at our workplace. and really, especially given all the white supremacy there and the racism and discrimination, that people who face that are likely to say something about it, because by even people who are beaten down and really face a lot of oppression will only take that sort of stuff for so long before they stand up. And when people have stood up as individuals, they've been let out the door, walked out the door in one way or another. And our hope is that not only can United SimpliSafe Workers be a means to struggle for betterment of the workers at our workplace, but also is a large part of the struggle against white supremacy in this country and patriarchy in this country too, given the huge amounts of sexual harassment that are present at our workplace. And I think those things are really interrelated, and we see it front and center, the brutality of the productive process for working people.
Yeah, I'm wondering if you could talk a bit more about the transformations that have taken place among the workers in the past few weeks. You said before that for months beforehand, people never stood up about much of anything. If they did, it was on their own. And in the last week, there was that petition, and there was a spontaneous work stoppage. And I'm wondering if you could talk a bit about the transformations in the workers and people seeing the basis to stand up together, and what is going to be needed in the future to continue that process and in this organization that was formed, the United SimpliSafe Workers.
Well, there was definitely a huge, well, I would say like a somewhat huge transformation with the employees to even have a work stoppage. I feel like the only reason why they ever stopped it is because my two other coworkers beside me were actually able to stand up and start pumping their fist as well, and many other people, because they've seen what was going on with management, and that not everything is as peachy cream as they want it to be. But all I have to say is that we definitely were, it's definitely was tough. Like when I first got there in July, I definitely saw that everyone, there wasn't really much of any type of resistance, even though I first met Ryan and Abbie, and they were definitely saw what was going on with management and everything. But I myself was kind of like still, you know, wearing my rose colored glasses. So I didn't really like delve too deeply into like resisting, but it was more so like when I started to see like I've seen multiple people get fired, I've seen huge transformations, and I've seen so many injustices with coworkers that have very personal things happening at home and don't really have the time to put much effort into work, and it didn't seem like management was very forgiving of people's circumstances or situations. And so that really did lead me to delve more deeper in trying to better our work conditions. And like, and I'm seeing that like there's a lot of things that need to be done. There seems to be like a communication issue between management and employees. It seems like we're always the last to find out about something. And it really does leave us at a disadvantage of how to even convey any information to the customer, because it leaves us looking very stupid on the phone. And so there is that. If there's no communication, there's no respect, and therefore this is what led to with the bedbug issue. There's obviously no respect in how they didn't tell us what was going on that span from March. And so there definitely needs to be a better like relationship.
I mean, I want to emphasize that a lot of the developments in the workplace have occurred pretty, this is all pretty fast, you know, for people, from the petition just last week to people standing up, and that there's a real process of people coming together that doesn't happen right away. Even if we look historically at the United States, when we could see the 60s and 70s as maybe a high point or high tide in the workers' struggle, and the level of repression then that was levied against that, especially if we see what happened to the Panthers, Fred Hampton and others who were really knocked down by the state, and the level of a level of nihilism which has set in more broadly in the society about what is possible, you know, what that maybe some people think it is impossible to stand up. And of course, historically, time and time again, we see that when people stand up, things happen for the better, actually. And there's a necessity and a potential to do so always. But then at the same time, these things sometimes happen at first in small ways. So at first, when people were being threatened with interrogation and possible firing, and I stood up, not everyone chanted at first. You know, my side, I was first just saying what seemed to be going on. But others stood by my side, even if they didn't speak at that point. And others kind of made motions in solidarity. And then since then, people have been saying, too, kind of the reaction of seeing the police sent in so quickly. And why did they have to send in the police so quickly? And what did that represent? That it was that the reaction right away was to call the cops, even though there was no interruption at that point. That even though we've been seeing people being fired silently and the cops weren't there, in a sense, the cops have been there all along, actually. You know, and this really sinks in with a lot of people's experiences very negatively with the police, you know, both in Boston and its relationship with white supremacy and throughout the country. So these things are kind of the subject of a lot of conversations occurring among our coworkers right now, and really powering a lot of the basis for us to come together in a strong and meaningful way. That's not simply a mechanical basis of saying, oh, this is just a simple issue about bed bugs or about workers' rights or about, you know, salary issues. This is about a lot more. It's about the need to stand up, really. So those transformations are really something to see. They're in process right now.
I think that's really well said by both Abbie and Lauren. And I just want to emphasize, I think a major aspect of how these transformations have occurred is, you know, before, a lot of people, given the very difficult circumstances they faced, their idea was, keep my head down. I'm going to keep my head down. I'll go to work. I'll, you know, clock in. I'll get paid. I'll go home. Despite facing all the injustices, some people eventually do stand up one-on-one or as individuals. But as more and more people kind of came together and this petition was signed, the dynamic really changed. Instead of just being able to say, I'll keep my head down, I'll go to work, I'll go home, the question in the office, it became, do you stand with the petition or are you against it? Do you stand with the request for a very, very simple request that we had, just an apology for the dishonesty and just transparency on what was going forward from there, like the spraying and how people were being helped who had been contracted bed bugs in the office. We got neither of those. And so then these questions arise. Okay, so then, you know, how do you stand with regards to the response from the company? How do you stand with their attempts to interrogate people illegally and illegally fire people? All of those questions now are being taken up by our coworkers. Not everyone, but many people. And that's so inspiring to see, not just a few of us, but a large number of people kind of asking these questions, grappling with them, and putting forward their ideas about this and other aspects of the workplace and the oppressive reality there. And I just think that really has been quite a transformation, and it's not something you see every day, really there's been new repressive measures implemented by SimpliSafe, including, as I mentioned, disabling key cards, including, as I mentioned, posting supervisors at the doors. Abbie mentioned putting new people in the seats, so people who have been suspended, all of these to try to push things back to the normal, in quotes, because what sort of normal is that? Try to pretend like nothing ever happened. But clearly something did happen here. People took a stand against injustice and against oppression and really did change the dynamic. And we hope to carry that forward and continue to the struggle for a more democratic workplace, for a safer workplace, and for just better working conditions in general so people can really have a voice and a say in what goes on. Because 40 hours a week that people spend there or more, that's not an insignificant amount of time. And we can't just keep our heads down and hope that, you know, we'll go home at the end of the day and be okay. I mean, the reality is that it's so brutal. We need to stand up. We need to struggle for change.
Yeah, yeah, it's all really useful and good to hear. I'm wondering if you could talk a bit about the next steps ahead of United SimpliSafe Workers now and the situation that you're all are facing.
In terms of the next steps, you know, we're really standing strong, I think, in making the case that this is not just about bed bugs, that this is not, that really what's transformed here is not something that could be swept under the rug like most of the things at the workplace have been, and that we're there to support each other right now, and we're there to provide a platform for people to speak about their experience, speak about what they think should and can happen. and to really back each other up for that. You know, that there hasn't been that basis to do so. People are used to accepting that the best that can happen is keep your head down low again, clock in, clock out, get the hell out of there before something bad happens. And instead, what we're seeing now is that we're seeing that our coworkers are really amazing people and are very strong people and very knowledgeable people, and that there's just an amazing potential to bring this together, to really see your own voice be projected and our own power maintained, actually. And that there are other people right nearby us in downtown Boston and across Boston who also have similar struggles too, who were more than interested and welcome to really discuss these things with them too. And to say that, no, you're not alone, that these struggles are not simply individual isolated cases, and that workers are not simply isolated individual objects that have nothing in common with each other, that we have a responsibility to come together. So I think that's where we are right now.
A few more comments on the next steps. We have been outside our workplace every morning and some afternoons since Thursday the 9th. And we've been, you know, talking with our coworkers and had a few little chants and stuff like that, and talking to people as they pass by. It's not surprising. Many people who work in the same office building, because I think there's 10 floors there or something, are quite horrified to hear about what's been going on. There's also a health clinic there, and people are concerned about the health risks of the bed bug infestation. And the thing is, you know, the hope is to sustain the struggle and to get us reinstated, those of us who have been suspended in retaliation for our protected concerted activity. And the hope is to also seriously transform the working conditions at the workplace. Today, we actually happened to catch the CEO as he was walking into the office and gave him a little letter with a list of the changes that we'd like to make, including a $5 an hour raise for all of us and our coworkers, including reinstatement of those of us who have been suspended, including an apology and transparency on the bedbug situation, which we still have not received, and including the company's recognizing the existence of United Simply Safe Workers and providing and acknowledging that as a platform for workers to come together collectively to bring up their ideas and their grievances with the workplace. And I think those are a meaningful aspect of the way we're going for a meaningful portion of the way we're going forward. We're also working to build a larger campaign around this issue to share it with other people at other workplaces, as Abbie mentioned, and also in the hopes that all progressive and democratic people around the Boston area and even around the country will support our struggle and hear about what's going on and see, maybe even seek inspiration from the work we're doing in a modest way. So those are a few of the steps forward as we see it. We're also talking to media outlets such as yourself and others.
And we might have mentioned it before, but if people were interested in seeing your United Simply Safe's their statements and the progression of the struggle and reaching out to you too, where would they go to do that?
They can go to our Facebook page. It's called United Simply Safe Workers, and you can see everything on there and get all the information that you need.
And we also have a change.org petition, which is linked there. I think it's got like 160 or 170 signatures so far, which is, I think, quite impressive given the short amount of time it's been up. There's also our Gmail address, UnitedSimplisafeWorkers@gmail.com, and people can reach out to us there with requests, you know, for media information, for interviews, just to hear about what we're doing. Yeah, so those are a few ways you can get in touch with us.
First time I'm saying this for the benefit of the workers and not just for the company, but Simply Safe is spelled with an I, just so you know. If you spell that email address, it's United Simply SimpliSafeWorkers, not Y, safeworkers@gmail.com.
Yeah, yeah. I wanted to say that everything you all have been saying was really well said, and it's been really inspiring to hear about the ways that you've all stood up to really oppressive conditions there, and hope to hear more good news in the future. I was wondering if you had any last thoughts to share for people who are listening in.
The revolution will not be televised.
All right, great.
Well, yeah, I think that there's more to that. Like, there's so much going on right now. This is part of it that we're here, but, you know, let's talk with each other. If this motivates you, don't just stay right there. You know, let's get linked up, because we got to seize the time. And there's multiple levels to doing that. So, yeah, I agree with that.
Yeah, well, it's been great talking to you all today. Once more, this is Tidal Patterns. I'm going to play a few songs, and then we'll transition to Beatrice's show. But thanks for tuning in. And, yeah, I'll be here next week.
Tus hijos del alquiler y algo.